Thanks for joining us and welcome to the Hop Center webinar speaker series, Hoppy Topics. My name is Darren and I am part of the success team here at Hop Center. The Hop Center webinar speaker series, Hoppy Topics, is a free online educational seminar with presentations from our lead researchers and hop scientists. I will host a new speaker with me here every Tuesday throughout the months of May and June to keep you up to date on industry trends and helpful insights. Under current stay-at-home orders, we hope these presentations help bring supportive inspiration to your lives and your craft. Each presentation was created to address hop-related challenges brewers face on a daily basis, and we hope their latest discoveries help you in your quest to brew better beer. Before I introduce you to our guest speaker, everyone should know that comments and questions are absolutely welcome. Each will be addressed at the end of the webinar using the Q&A tab at the bottom of your screens. Also, if there is a hoppy topic our speaker series did not address, shoot us a comment or suggestion. We'd love to hear from you. A link with each webinar recording will be available on our website under the online customer portal page shortly after each presentation. Simply sign up on our website to watch or download. And without further ado, here with us today is Frank Pfeiffer, Technical Director of Product Development at Hop Center Germany, along with our questions moderator, Mike Sutton, Vice President of Craft Sales. Frank started his brewing career 35 years ago after receiving his degree as an engineer in brewing science and beverage technology from the Technical University of Munich. Prior to his career at Hopsteiner, Frank worked at the Wahensteffener Brewery as Director of Operations. Frank currently supports R&D activities at Hopsteiner for new product development and technical applications, many of which have been published in several international brewing journals across the globe. In his most recent 20 plus years in the field, Frank has served as a trusted advisor for the Master Brewers exams at the IHK in Munich and as a technical confidant to breweries both large and small across the globe. Frank, thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Darren. Good morning and hello everybody here from Germany. My topic today is the hops bitterness, the hop aroma, and what lies beyond. So what does it mean? I will talk a little bit about bitterness, bittering compounds, and the relevance of certain bitter compounds, especially regarding bitter hops and aroma hops. Then we go to the aroma side. I want to show you somehow you can determine and describe aroma in hops in beer. And we talk a little bit about single beers produced and dry hop with single hopping and blends. And then some news about some masking effects occurs by hop aroma compounds. And then we come to the most important part of this presentation, all the things around, anything else that we have there regarding special properties from certain hop compounds on light stability, antioxidative and antibacterial effects, and regarding the foam stability of our beers. So at the beginning, to warm up, give you a short overview to come into this topic. Here we have the most relevant compounds of our hop cones that makes around 25 to 30% of the whole volume of the hops. It's a part in the polyphenols, the resins, and into the hop oils. So these three big fractions, they have the most impact on the processing and production of our beers. And let's start with the polyphenols. That is a group that affects the stability of a beer regarding haze. It affects also the antioxidative stability of a beer because the polyphenols are able to neutralize aggressive oxidants. In the middle, we have the resins, where we can talk about soft resins and hard resins, two groups. From the group of the soft resins, we already know the alpha acids, the beta acids, and we also have some unspecified soft resins. The beta acids are relatively unsoluble because of the low pH that appears when the pH drops at the beginning of fermentation. So they're not relevant in beer, but alpha acids, then in the form of the isoalpha acids. And these guys, I will explain later on what their impact is in beer production. And on the right side, we have the hard resins. We also have oxidation products. We have some unspecific hard resins. They have an impact on bitterness. And what we all know, this is a group of xanthohumol, the prenyl flavonoids, with special properties. Some nice pictures from the hop cone that is close to harvest, where we see the stamp inside, and there we have the lupulin glands and the leaf material, the bracts and the bracteoles, and then a microscopical view of these lupulin glands we have here on the right side. They have a diameter around 100 micrometer. They contain mainly the bitter compounds and the hop oil, the aroma compounds, and they all have a very fine skin to cover these compounds in these small yellow bubbles. In the old days, we were talking about aroma varieties and bitter varieties, and then we had also the definition as dual purpose varieties. That was something in between, some hop varieties with a little bit higher alpha acid concentration and certain aroma impression, but that is, let me say, that is from the past. Nowadays, we are only talking about aroma hops, and we talking about bitter hops. This is a very easy classification. And what is an aroma and what is a bitter hop? That is decided by the breeder, and that is what he has to add to his variety at the registration of the variety. All these hops have in common that they contain more or less alpha acids, and concentration is ranging from low 2% up to more than 20%. Let me say Polaris is now the leader here in the ground in the Hallertau with last crop 21%. And that is transferred into the alpha acids, into the isoalpha acids during wort boiling, depending on temperature, depending also on time, on the pH, and on the active catalyst. A little bit magnesium has to be there, coming from the brewing water or coming from the malt itself. Normally we calculate our hop dosage on the base of the alpha acids. And that's not wrong regarding the traditional beer styles where we use hops, or we have hop additions in the brew house, in the kettle, or in the whirlpool. And then we describe the bitterness as bitter units. That comes from the laboratory, something you can measure with a relatively unspecific method, where you measure the isoalpha acids, and if you have alpha acids, if you have humulinones as well, they are also measured with this method of the international bitter units. I think that my colleague Jean-Paul May described this behavior, especially regarding dry hop beers, in one of the last presentations here in our webinar series. So the definition is that 1 ppm of isoalpha acids is 1 IBU in beer. That means that is 1 unit of perceived bitterness, what we can taste. And this is ranging from 10 to more than 100, especially dry hop beers. Sometimes they show relatively high values of IBUs, but that's not all isoalpha acid related. You also measure the alpha acids coming from dry hopping, and you also measure humulinones infused by dry hopping as well. And that sometimes leads to much higher IBU value compared to the IBUs that you can find in your mouth by tasting. So regarding the sensory evaluation of the bitterness, we have the intensity that comes from the amount of bitter compounds in the beer. Then there's the quality, or we can call it as well harmony. That's what people describe as smoothness, or on the other side, with harshness or lingering bitterness. And we always have a bitter profile that sometimes can be a little bit different from the quality, from the harmony, but most of the time it goes very similar. If you have a nice and good bitter profile, that relates to a good quality of the bitterness. Here on this slide, I have information about the perceived bitterness that comes from certain hop bitter compounds, certain hop bitter acids, because we have very high differences in between this. Let me say the value of 1.0, that is regarding the perceived bitterness of the isoalpha acids. And we see here for xanthiumol and also for the alpha acids, that is very low. Alpha is just around 10% bitter compared to the bitterness of isoalpha acids. Then we go to the humulinones, the oxidated form of the alpha acids. Good solubility, special in dry hop beers, we find reasonable high levels with, let me say, a positive bitter impact, but the bitterness is also much lower with 0.66 compared to the isoalpha acids. And that is rho, that is a reduced form of the isoalpha acids. It's a light stable bitter acid that we have in special compositions for light stable beer in the kettle and also for downstream application. And here we have our isoalpha acids with one unit perceived bitterness per ppm. And the last one in the row, that is tetra. Tetra is also a reduced isoalpha acid. Tetra has the can be used to create better foam stability, and it's also light stable. And if you use tetra in a water solution, you will find out that it's a little bit more bitter than isoalpha acids. And some people say it's in between 1 and 1.3, but when you add tetra hydroisoalpha acids into a beer, you will find that the beer matrix behaves a little bit different compared to water. And regarding this, you will see that this very close to the value of the isoalpha acids. So normally we do our calculation with 1.0 instead of 1.2 or 1.3, for example. So what is the profile, or how can we define the bitter profile of different groups of hops? Let's start here with a super high alpha, where we have alpha values that goes over 15, 16%, where we have a very fast coming bitterness. It goes to a very high summit, and it disappears the same way again here on the right side. So it's a very short impact from the bitterness. Then we have, let me say, high alpha varieties with an alpha concentration that is a little bit below 14%. So you see it's not that high anymore, and it takes more time that the bitterness comes up and also that the bitterness goes down at the end. Then regular bitter hops, something around 12%, takes a little bit more time to come to the summit and also to generate back. And here we have the aroma hops with a very smooth bitterness. The summit is not that high, it's not that spit. Compared to the super high alpha acids. And this bitterness we define as more harmony. It comes slower, it goes up, and it stays a little bit longer, but not too long in your mouth. You see here at the end of this time, everything comes back again to zero. So everything depends now on the ratio of the alpha acids and, let me say, the other bittering components. And we have, let me say, big differences in the world of the hops, especially in between the bitter hops and the aroma hops regarding this ratio. And it really depends on the variety. It also depends a little bit on the crop situation. And especially here in Europe, we have a lot of differences in weather conditions and climatical conditions in between certain crops. And we have seen a movement of the ratio of alpha to the other bittering compounds. Especially when we have a drought, the varieties, they tend to produce more other bittering compounds compared to alpha. And then the ratio is a little bit in direction to the other bittering compounds. How can we describe and how can we measure it? The difference between the bitter varieties and the aroma varieties. We have two options for the raw material, for the hops. One method in the laboratory that we use is the LCV, that is the liquid conductance value. Some people call it MEBAG, or that is the EBC 7.5 that's mentioned on the Foilbeck, for example, for pellets, where we measure all bitter compounds, the alpha acids and the non-specific bitter compounds coming from the soft resin side and also coming from the hard resin side. We also have the option to use the HPLC method, but the HPLC method only covers the alpha acids and not the non-specific bitter compounds. So that is not a full screening. When we talk about, let me say, for example, an extract where we are not able to produce the whole range of non-specific compounds or only in a few scale, then the HPLC method is the right one to measure the alpha acid concentration, because that is now more or less the worth giving compound in an extract. Now we see here that there's a big difference in between the bitter varieties regarding the non-specific amount and the aroma varieties regarding the non-specific amount. And so when you're talking about the whole worth giving range of bitter compounds in beer production, we also have to look on this one, on the LCV value, where we see the whole impact from all the bittering or bitter giving compounds we have in this variety, especially when we are using aroma varieties, where it can sometimes be more than 20% ratio or more 20% on the side of the non-specific compounds. Here's a list with the long-term average of the ratio. The ratio means that it's the LCV to the HPLC value. And starting with some bitter varieties from Germany, Magnum Taurus Hercules, and we also have listed three bitter varieties from the US. And here we normally find ratios that is around or below 1.1. And then on the right side, we have the aroma varieties, some very special aroma varieties here from the Hallertau, and we also have Cascade, Willamette, and Mount Hook from the United States. And here we see completely different ratios, and they are all normally higher than 1.1. And that gives an information about, okay, this hop is, for me, it's an aroma hop. And have a look on Saphir, that could sometimes go up more than 1.3, and so we always have to calculate with this impact coming from the non-specific bitter compounds to make beer. We also have a very high impact from the hard resins. The hard resins we measure also according to the EBC 7.5, so that is in the same method with the LCV. And so the hard resin, that is the difference between the total resins and the soft resins. In Saphir, representing aroma variety, compared to Hercules, representing a bitter variety, we have relatively lower amount in percentage of hard resins. But the alpha value in Safir is, let me say, normally around 5%, and the alpha value of Hercules is normally around 15 to 16%. And that has a big impact when we want to produce a beer with 20 bitter units. So we need a certain amount of this variety each to make a beer to achieve 20 bitter units. And we can imagine that for regarding Hercules, it's a much lower dosage of hops compared to Safir. And at the end, in this beer with 20 bitter units, one produces Safir and the other one with Hercules, we come to this result that the addition of hard resins, and they really have a positive bitterness, a positive soft bitterness in the beer, is much higher. It's nearly three times more than regarding the hard resin impact coming from the Hercules in the other beer. So that describes very well how the non-specific bitter compounds and the hard resins especially have an impact on the beer processing and finally in the beer. Now let's have a look what we measure in the beer. And we have our IBU method where we measure the whole amount of bitter compounds. It doesn't matter if this is isoalpha acids or alpha acids or hard resins here in the non-specific area, or if it is coming from humulinones. That is completely integrated in the method of the IBU analytics. And on the other hand, we are also able to measure the isoalpha acids and also the remaining alpha acids with the HPLC method. For the bitter varieties, let me say a beer produced with a bitter variety, these values come very close together sometimes. That is 90% and that is 100%, or 93% and that is 100% compared to the IBUs. But when we produce a beer with aroma varieties, we see that there can be a big discrepancy in the determination, or between the determination via HPLC and the determination via the IBUs. So in extreme, there can be a difference also in the perceived bitterness, that we think we have we have the HPLC value and can set it one by one together with the IBUs, but the perceived bitterness behaves completely different, so that the beer has a little bit more bitterness in your mouth compared to the HPLC value that we have measured in the laboratory. We have many factors to keep under consideration regarding the bitterness of a beer. So which compounds or what has an impact on the bitterness? Yes, we have to start with the bitter compounds, and especially with the hopping technology. And yes, the bitter compounds from the hops, we have talked about this, they have the highest impact on the bitterness, but also the composition of the bitter compounds given by the variety or by the hop product itself has also a very high impact on the bitterness coming from the hops, and we find later on in the beer. Then we go to the polyphenols. We know that polyphenols can also taste bitter, especially when polyphenols are aged. And so by aging of polyphenols, they can tend to taste bitter, and that can be end into a perceived bitterness coming from polyphenols and not all derived by the hop bitter compounds. Hop oils. Normally, hop oils have no bitterness. Remember my presentation last week. Hop oils have aroma compounds, but they sometimes have an impact on the perceived taste and flavor of a beer. And especially, they can cover some compounds. And we think when we have a certain concentration of hop aroma compounds added by hop oils into a beer, they also have an impact on the perceived bitterness. Then we go to the malt. Malt comes in with different degrees of roasting, of color. That has an impact on bitterness. Maillard products can taste a little bit bitter. We also can talk about the impact from proteins from malt. They can tend to be bitter, especially when you use a lot of wheat malt or raw wheat or other cereals with a high protein concentration. Then we are talking about a protein bitterness. And also water can have a negative impact on the bitterness of a beer. Have a look on the concentration of magnesium in your water, in your brewing water. And because when magnesium comes together with sulfate, you have magnesium sulfate, and that is has a very bitter taste. So that is also one explanation and one reason why the different beer styles were developed in different areas around the world. In the old days, the brewers had no impact to control the water hardness, and they had to create their beers regarding to the water that came up from a well or from a spring. Then yeast can also have an impact on bitterness, but it's not already formulated that it maybe comes from autolysis, that some internal elements from the yeast cells go into solution and has a negative influence on the bitterness of the beers. And overall, the beer matrix, the type of beer, for example, compare a stout with a lager beer, then you notice a bitterness coming from the beer itself, because that is the style of the beer, and is impacted mainly by the usage of roasted malts here in a kind of stout beer. So let's start now to talk a little bit about aroma and aroma assessment. Let me go back 8 years or 10 years. All the people were talking about hop bitterness and utilization of hop bitter compounds. And now we are in a complete different world, especially regarding the new technologies, regarding the new craft industry. Now, hop flavor, hop aroma compounds, there are no more off flavors, because they are needed to create special products. And brewers are crazy to look for new varieties with new and special flavors all around the world. The difference between the old traditional hopping technology in the brew house and the new technology that we use, especially in dry hopping, is that now on we have no more evaporation of the essential oils, and we are able to transfer the whole range of aroma compounds coming with the hop directly into the beer. And we are more or less able to detect with our palate these aroma compounds, but we're doing hard to describe what it is, what is the speciality, and what do we like and what we not like. And we are looking with big energy to find more about the assessment of hop oils, of hop oil compounds in our analysis, in our methods, to get more insight into the world of hop aroma. Sometimes people think that the flavor coming from a hop cone will probably be the same later on in the beer. Sometimes that's right, absolutely, but it also depends a little bit on more parameters, like on the type of beer, on the yeast that you are using, on the gravity and alcohol content of the beer. So sometimes it can be very close together, but sometimes it can differ very much. To assess the aroma profile of hop varieties, let me say of leaf hops, and also of beers produced with these varieties, we constructed this, let me say, aroma wheel. And it's just, let me say, one example how this tool helps to assess the explanation and describing about aroma profile in a variety and also about the aroma or about the aroma profile in a beer. And you see here we have a lot of different namings, fruitiness, floral, herbal, for example, and with sub divisions where you can type in what you think, what you smelled or what you tasted, and then you can also vote between 0 and 5 to produce finally a kind of spider web diagram that describes the variety or that describes the beer. What we also have to know is that sometimes, yes, the availability of a certain variety is limited because the acreage is, very low, or it's very exclusive, or there's a very high demand on this variety, or there's something was going on with bad weather conditions, a hail or storm or whatever can impact the availability of a variety. So let me say that's one reason why people think about using hop blends. Hop blends are very important because if you use more than variety in a blend, you create a new aroma in your product, in your beer. And the more different varieties you use, the more independent you are from a single variety, so that you can substitute one variety when it's not available in the next crop because of the certain or bad climatical conditions. We know that some flavors, they come together with synergetic effects by different hop aroma compounds, so that addition of another compound increases the value or the relevance of the others. So that is something that is hard to describe, and that's nearly impossible to find out by analytics, but that's something that we can smell and taste with your palate. We can also talk about transformation that comes later, and we have different and much more different now hopping techniques that we can use. We have dry hopping, we have late hopping, we have first wet hopping, we have wet hopping, and so on and so on. So a lot of things that came up in the last years and helps us to produce more and more different beers. So that is what the brewers are looking for. How we can describe certain fruit aromas. They can appear in a variety, in a single variety. They also can appear in a blend. And that's something, or sometimes it's very unique for a variety, that you have very high noticeable amount of a special aroma impression. And that is what we are looking for in our breeding activities, not only in the United States, also in Germany, since many years now. And with a look on the next slide, we see our released varieties over the last years coming from our company, Hopsteiner. Here, the Super Galena, the Apollo, and Delta, they were at the beginning, as well as the Bravo. And then we had a second release, let me say, of nice aromatic lemon drop. And then we had the Eureka. And the latest one were Sultana and Lotus during the last 1.5 years coming from the United States. From Germany, our breeding is relatively young, and we released in last year the variety Akoya, and we released in 2020 the variety Solero. Just some examples about what we are doing, and if you want to have or get more information about these varieties, you can ask my colleagues, and you can also have a look into our webpage. So that is a spider web diagram that comes out of this aroma wheel assessment. And we once said, okay, now let's make some blends and see what comes out. For example, when we use a Calypso blend together with a Cascade, and we see here that the addition was 300 gram per hectoliter each, but the impact on the bitter units were a little bit inhomogeneous because, yes, we know that we have a certain extraction of bitter compounds from the hop addition at dry hopping. That has an impact on the bitter units as well. So we produce two beers with 300 gram per hectoliter each. And then we blended the final beers 50% to 50%. And now let's have a look on the outcome regarding the description of the aroma profile. So that's the one for Calypso. It goes into the citrusy and fruity direction, but it also has here a very spicy background, a little bit sugar-like as well. And here we have the Cascade. That's very typical for us, Cascade. High spiciness and a high peak in citrusy, a little bit less than Calypso in fruitiness. And that is what came out in the blend 50-50. So here we see that we have now an increased aroma impression regarding fruitiness and much more in citrusy. So the other thing is nearly the same, but here we can say in this blend, 50% Cascade and 50% Calypso, we found a positive effect, an increasing effect regarding this aroma impression, citrusy and fruitiness. And something that goes into the other direction was also found. We used now a lemon drop, a Calypso and a Cascade beer produced with 300 gram per hectoliter as well. And then we made a blend out of these beers with 1/3 lemon drop beer, 1/3 Calypso and 1/3 Cascade. So that is our lemon drop. That is typical for lemon drop, a high citrusy note, a high fruitiness and sugar-like and a little bit spiciness. So very, very aromatic, very fruity and citrusy hop. And then we added the Calypso and the Cascade that we know from the last trials. But in the end, the blend was not very promising. We lost fruitiness, was lower than what we expected, what we found in the single varieties. And also citrusy was on a lower level compared to lemon drop. Let me say, all in all, it was not sufficient for us to recommend this blend to get a better result out of the of these varieties in the blend. We all know that thinalol is a key indicator for aroma compound, for hop aroma, especially in late hop beers. And last session, I explained the the thinalol can cover off flavors like aged beers that we had there, for example. And now we found something together with a well-known West German brewery. They had a beer with a high DMS concentration. And yes, the threshold of the DMS was 129 in the base beer that only had a 7 microgram per liter linalool. And then we added 15 microgram per liter linalool. So that was 22 completely. And then the threshold was increasing from 129 to 176. That's a big range. But on the other hand, by adding more linalool, it fell down again. So we did it again, second time, and we came to the same result. So there must be something happened, especially in this concentration that you add to the beer with a DMS off flavor. And then you have the effect that the threshold is increasing, but it can also be going down again. So we see that linalool has an impact on this kind of off flavors as well. We know that the terpene alcohols, they come together in a form where especially geraniol is bounded as a geraniol precursor. And that has a big potential in certain hop variety, especially in our varieties Bravo, Sultana, and in the experimental 09326 that's maybe coming up next time, next year's with a certain name. But potential regarding geraniol precursors is very high. And so we see that within semantical release coming from the yeast, starting directly after fermentation, we can release a lot of geraniol into beer. And out of this, we can generate, let me say, a coexistence of geraniol with linalool, citronellol, and terpenol. We see that this compound groups, these terpene alcohol, they look more or less a little bit similar, but the aroma impression is not always the same, so they differ a little bit, and everything tends to go into direction of terpenol and of beta citronellol. And this is what the name says, is citronellol is a citric taste that you can find and describe like a citrusy or lime-like note. And this aroma is increased when you give the hops a chance to let the precursor or to split the geraniol precursor into free geraniol. And on the other side, you will normally find a glycoside. For this, you need this enzyme that comes from the yeast, that is a beta glycosidase that is splitting the 1,4 binding of the sugar with the geraniol into these two molecules. Now coming to the next next point that I want to present you. We all know the problem with this light struck flavor. And we, all scientists, have found that this 3-MBT, that is 3-methylbutanediol, is responsible to give this, let me say, this skunky aroma into beers. And this molecule comes from a side arm from the alpha and from the isoalpha acids. That's all well known. And when you have beers in flint glass bottles or in green glass bottles in the sunlight, and you will taste it because the threshold is very, very low. You see that it's 0.12 microgram per liter. But now we found that also these compounds, 3-methyl-thiopropanol and dimethyl-disulfide, have also an impact that goes into the cooked potato or sulfury cabbage-like direction. That is very close to the sulfury, skunky aroma impression that we have from the 3-MBT. So this one is hop-derived, and these guys here, they are malt-derived. That means for us, for the brewers, okay, there's something else, something more than the 3-MBT from the hops. There's also something, sulfury components from the source of malt. And they have an overall impact on the light struck flavor in the beer. People talking a lot about the stability, the antioxidative property of a beer. And for this, some scientists in Berlin, they made a special test program with the ESR, the electron spin resonance spectroscopy, where they produced two beers. One was single hopped at the beginning of the boil, and the other one was incremental hopped with a hop addition at the beginning, in the middle, and at the end of the boil. The calculation here goes to 110%, because we have to know that with the late addition, I have a lower utilization and isomerization rate. And to compensate this, to get a beer that has later on the same bitterness, these guys had to adjust the addition here by 10%. What came out was, after each hop addition, this ESR value fell down, and then it came up again. And with the next hop addition here, the second hop addition and the third hop addition, regarding the incremental hop dosage, it was going down again. And at the end, at knockout, they found, okay, there's a delta ESR in between the two beers. So the one with a single hop addition has a much higher potential of radicals than the beer that was hopped incremental with three hop dosages. And that has a very big impact later on the flavor quality and on the flavor stability of the beer. I will show you this one because we used this as a blueprint for some tests that we did here in Mainburg in Germany. So we produced a beer. It was not that strange. We had a hoppage dosage of 70% at the beginning of the boil and here 30% at the end of the boil, and the beer before was hopped with 4 hop additions at the beginning, at the middle, close to knockout, and then later on in the whirlpool. We used this variety, that was Smaragd Zephyr, here at the beginning and here after 22 minutes, and later on we only used Zephyr. We boiled the beer, we brewed for 70 minutes, and then we did the fermentation with the same yeast, and then we measured a lot of different things, so that is not very interesting. But here we see that the foam was a little bit better regarding the beer with the 4 additions. We also see there's a big little difference in between the bitter units, and the late additions had a lower isomerization rate, and that's the reason for this 27 to 30 bitter units, so it's a little bit lower on this side. And we see that linalool is also impacted by late hop additions. The longer the hop boils in the kettle, the more of the linalool is also evaporated. And that's the reason why here we found 64, and for the 4 hop additions with a special late hop addition, we found 95 microgram per liter. But that was not all. We made tastings at the drink tech with more than 200 or 240 tasters, and we found that especially the people from America and the people from Asia, they found differences in between the 2 beers, number 2 and number 4. And so the recommendation was more on the sides for beer B4 for the Asian people and also for the North American and South American people. And then we tried to fix it in evaluation regarding DLG. We made a tasting with the beer with 2 hop additions after 6 months under cold conditions, and here after 6 months under warm conditions. And here we see the impact especially of warm environments, that the points were very low, and the lower the DLG points are, the more worse the beer is at the end of the day. But compare to the beers with the 4 hop additions, there's a very big gap, and you see that these products with 4 hop additions, even when it was stored under warm conditions for half a year, got much better result and much better voting compared to the beer with 2 hop additions. So that has a big impact on the quality, especially on the quality on the shelf for these beers. And we also measured the indicators for oxidation and for thermal, and this goes together into these aging indicators as a sum up. And we saw here for the fresh beer, B2, it turned after 6 months into higher results regarding all these 3 indicators. And then compare with the beer with 4 hop additions. At the beginning, it was lower when the beer was fresh. And even then, later on the shelf, after 6 months under warm conditions, we also have lower values. So what we've found in tasting, we can also correlate to the analysis of all the known aging indicators that we can have in beers coming from oxidation or from heat. So we know that there's an antibacterial property to find in a lot of bitter compounds, and they are used to prevent food or beer spoilage. They're also used in the ethanol production or especially for meat production. And they all work against these gram-positive bacteria. So they cannot spoil, they cannot grow, and they can also not cause any microbiological off flavor. And to talk about this single bitter compounds, normally we have this beta acids. They have the highest antimicrobial or antibacterial potential, but the problem is the beta acids, their solubility is very low, especially when the pH drops down or when the temperatures are very low. They normally are used here in the ethanol production and a little bit in small amounts for the protection of meat products. We also have found a very high antibacterial potential here in the alpha acids and also in tetra. But this is just a list, and more about this studies will follow in the next weeks in different literature on the market, because we did a very long and intensive research on this. We know that especially beers with a low bitterness, they can be critical sometimes, especially when the BUs are around 10 or 12 or below this. So especially there, people or the brewers have to take care, much more care than the others, where you have bitter units going up to 100, for example. Now let's come to the foam stability. And we have some compounds, they impact the foam positively, especially proteins and the CO2 gas that forms the bubbles, that's the gas for the bubbles. And we also have some additives like a propionate we call alginate that some people use to create a better foam stability. Then we have polysaccharides coming from the malt. They have an impact on the foam. And the metal ions, they can also be foam positive, but normally we don't want them in our beers because they work like a catalyst and they tend to form radicals, and that leads into a very low stability of the taste. We also know that some hop bitter compounds are involved regarding the creation of foam, and especially the tetrahydroisoalpha acids and also the normal alpha acids. They are good, very good foam enhancer, and I will show this now with some slides how they behave and what they can do for a beer. So we once made a trial with a increasing addition of tetra. The reference beer, yes, was okay with 210 seconds regarding the Niebuhr method. The foam was not that good, but you see here, even with an addition of 5 ppm or then with 10 ppm, you can increase the foam dramatically. Especially tetra comes to a limit that's around 15 ppm when the addition is too high, that the foam looks a little bit artificial and the impact on the taste of the beer, the bitterness is not the same, not what you want, what you like at the end of the day. So tetra is limited, let me say, to 10 ppm addition, but with a very high and good impact on the foam stability. Then we compared the control beer. Let me say this one has a 100% foam stability with the addition of isoalpha acids, with an addition of alpha acids, and here with the addition of tetra. And we found out with an increasing or with the same dosage, we have a very good situation here, very good result regarding a better foam stability. And also the lacing that is describing how the foam is sticking on the glass when the foam disappears, when the foam goes down, is very good for alpha and also very good for tetra as well. What we tested was also the impact on different temperatures when we measure our beer foam. So there was a light beer, was only kettle hopped with and then added with 3 ppm of the hop acids. And we measured with the Niebuhr method the foam stability in seconds for the control beer, for a beer added with alpha, with isoalpha acids, for the beer added with alpha acids, and for the addition with the tetra under different temperatures. That means at 20 degrees centigrade, that is normally the temperature where we do the method according the MEBAC analysis, and we did also with 10 degrees centigrade, and that is a little bit closer to drinking temperature than 20 degrees centigrade. And we see there's a very high impact regarding the results on different temperatures. And that is what I want to say to you. Have a look on your analytics that you always have the same temperature where you measure it to compare the beer quality, especially regarding foam. And sometimes there are laboratories, they tend to be getting warmer than 20 degrees, especially in summertime. And then you have another negative effect on your foam stability. So the foam tends to be much worse than at the real temperature level. And normally at 10 degrees, you should have a better foam than at 10 degrees, at 20 degrees centigrade. That is how it looks. Here's a control beer, the base beer, and then we have an addition of 4 ppm alpha acids, and here of 40 ppm PGA. And that was recommended to increase the foam quality by 30 seconds. And here we can see that we had a very good result regarding the alpha acids. We had also good lacing. Here the foam material stays here on the glass. The surface of the foam is on this level, and here for the control beer and also for the PGH, the result was not that good than for the alpha acid addition. Okay, now coming to the end of the presentation, time is passing by, and I hope that I was able to show you something that was a little bit out of the range, especially regarding the ELTS properties of certain hop compounds and their functionalities and the special applications. And now you have time to ask your questions, and my colleague Mike will read it so that I can answer to you. Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you, Frank. So, appreciate the good information there. We have a couple questions, and let's go ahead and jump into those. Do you have information on the usefulness of mash hopping or first wort hopping? And are these practices related to any oxidant capacity of hops?
Oh, excuse me, no, I'm back again. I was muted. We are doing now trials regarding mash hopping and first wort hopping. What I think that especially the first wort hopping has a positive impact also on this formation of radicals, that every time you add alpha acids into the brew, you also remove some iron ions, and this iron normally has as a catalyst has a tends to form radicals. And we did it once with the beer because we were interested also in the utilization of first wort hopping, and we found very positive results regarding utilization of the bitter compounds as well. And the utilization was a little bit higher than the utilization we found compared with the beer that was hopped at the beginning of the boiling. So I can recommend first wort hopping. That's not bad, and maybe it makes sense to split the first additions in first wort hopping by 50% and then 50% hopping when you start boiling. That is my recommendation regarding this. But especially on mash hopping, I think there are so much material involved from the malt that maybe goes in interaction with bitter compounds, and I think that we will lost these compounds. We have no isomerization in our process, so I think we will not see a utilization from the alpha acids. And what comes out regarding the positive feedback on the formation of radicals, I don't know.
Okay, Why do aroma varieties have a higher proportion of uncharacterized resin components?
Yeah, that's a good question. That is something I will ask my colleague, the breeder, Alex. I think that's something in the genetics, that there's a link to produce a little bit less alpha and to produce some other compounds. But I have no clear answer on this.
Okay. What type of flavor implications come from tetra when used to improve foam characteristics?
So the flavor coming from tetra is up to 10 ppm addition. It's, let me say, neutral bitter. But it could tend, if you have a higher addition, but that normally makes no sense, because with 10 ppm you have a very good result regarding tetra as a foam enhancer. But if you go into higher additions, higher concentrations, it could be that the tetra hydroisoalpha acids give a little bit a more metal-like taste.
Yeah, just to add to that, I would think it also depends on the beer matrix, the style beer.
Absolutely.
That makes a big difference. And then next question related to tetra, how can you add the individual tetra acids alone?
How can...
I'm assuming they're meaning it, just how do you dose the tetra alone?
Okay. How do we dose tetra alone? When you use tetra, you normally dose it at the very last step, or before the last filtration step, if we have filtration. So you need a device to make an even dosage into your beer stream to have a good homogenization in your final product. And I think the best practice is to use a dosage pump that is working regarding the flow of the beer in the pipe.
Okay. And I know that in a webinar week after next, John Paul May is going to talk about that in more detail. And last question, do you have some kind of a guide of different hop combinations like you showed before, Cascade and other hops, so we can use those combinations to boost some characteristics in beer?
Yeah, that's something that we are working on, especially to describe the characteristic depends on the beer matrix that you are using. And when you do it always with the same base beer, let me say like a pale ale or an IPA, then you have just information how the blend or how a mixture of two or three varieties behave in this kind of beer, but you have no information about how it behaves in another style of beer. And it could behave much different. That is something that you find out by yourself.
Okay. Let me squeeze in one last question. Can you brew using only roe, and what would be the advantages or disadvantages? So I'm assuming he's asking adding roe in the kettle.
Yes, you can brew with roe, but my recommendation is always a light stable kettle extract. That is a very nice product from our house, where you have a CO2 extract where the alpha acids were transferred into roe isoalpha acid, and that is the right form. And there you also have the beta acid. You have the aroma compound and so on and so on. So that's much closer to the real hopping with a hop product like pellets or like extract. You can also only use roe, but that will act a little bit different. You will see that the utilization coming from roe regarding milligram per liter will be a little bit better than for the CO2 extract. But on the other hand, the perceived bitterness of roe hydroisoalpha acids is only 70% compared to the bitterness of the isoalpha acids. So you have to adjust it a little bit. But when you only using roe, nothing around, no beta, no aroma compounds, could be you will produce a beer. That's no discussion. But it could be that the whole composition will be different.
Okay.
And the whole mouthfeel. Right.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I'll turn it back over to Darren to wrap up.
Thank you, Mike.
Yeah, thank you again so much, Mike and Frank. And that wraps it up for today's webinar and our series of hoppy topics. Our next presentation will be right here at the same time next week with Frank introducing a new hop separation method from Braukon called the Braukon Hopsteiner. As always, links to each recording can be found by visiting our customer portal page on our website. If more questions come up, we're happy to answer via email directly. Once again, my name is Darren. Thanks for joining us and happy brewing.